Hey YouTube, today we're going to go over what makes a sports photo a good sports photo, and also what makes a sports photo a bad sports photo. So, as you can see, there is a terrible, terrible, terrible photo right in front of me, and I was going to be careful about this, so better safe than sorry. Why not use my own photos that I've taken in the past instead of taking other people's photos and being rude about it online? So I'm going to use my photos for this entire video. So everything you're going to see is my photos. So let's jump right into it. First, we're going to start off with what makes a photo bad. So let's enlarge this. Okay. Right in front of us. So some of you may think, well, no, what? Why is this a bad photo? It's great. You're seeing the coach talking to the players. If you're new to sports photography, this is great. This is great for you to see and great for you to learn right away. Unlike me, who learned the hard way and shot like this for quite some time. So first, let's talk about the gear that was used in this set of this game. For this game, I was using the 7D, the Canon 7D, and the Canon 7200 2.8 IS Mark II. So this is where the side comes in of the gear doesn't matter. I've made a previous video about saying gear does matter to an extent, but at the same time, it doesn't matter because look what's happening in this photo. I'm using about four, almost, when the Canon 7D was new, it was over $3,000 in camera gear, and I just produced a point-and-shoot photo. This is a point-and-shoot photo. There is no thought put into this image. There is no nothing. It's just I saw that. I picked up my camera, I pushed a button, and that's it. I didn't think about it. And you know, this might be a long video. I'm gonna try to keep it quick, but it's good. It'll be good for you guys to watch this and learn a lot from it. And I hope you guys get a lot of information out of this video. So why is this photo bad? Well, if you don't already know why it's bad, let me explain. First off, there is way too much dead space all around the athletes. This the subject. The subject is the football players out in the field with the coach talking to them. Look at all the dead space all around them. It's way too much. It's way too loose. It's not cropped. It's not cropped. You don't ugh. It's not right at all. It just look at it. It's a point and shoot photo. There is no artisticness in it. There's no thought put into this. This is a shot anybody can make, and you can't even tell that $3,000 worth of gear was used to make this photo. This looks like you could take it with your iPhone. I am embarrassed that I took this photo, and this will happen to all you guys. You guys are gonna take pictures and you're gonna think, wow, this is such a great shot, and then a year later, you're gonna look back and be like, what the hell was I thinking? And I do that every year. It's just gonna happen. You know, maybe you'll hit one point where you'll look it back and see some of your photos and be like, wow, these are great. But for the most part, this is gonna happen, especially when you're first starting out. This is when I was first starting out with football. This is when I first started photography. And it's pretty bad. So aside from the whole loose stuff with the framing, all the dead zone all around it, the grass, the field, the sky, it's just dead space. It's not framed properly. This looks terrible. What's even happening? What is in the photo that is so intriguing? What is in the photo that makes it worth taking a snap of? The guy on the left is scratching his ass almost, and I mean, there's nothing. Nothing at all. There's nothing happening. And you know, that's a very common problem and a mistake a lot of people make when they're even you know, even people that have been shooting for a while, I mean, it'll happen. You'll take a shot sometimes, you're like, what the hell was I thinking? So that's what's wrong with this shot. Moving on, let's see. Okay, I think for this game, I had a parent hire me, and if I remember correctly, we'll see as we go. They hired me, wanted me to photograph their kid, and their kid was on the sideline the whole time. And I was just like, wow, well, this is lovely. But still, getting the back of an athlete is only acceptable to a certain extent. There's a bunch of rules in sports photography and photography. You got the Sunny 16, the rule of thirds, and you know all that stuff. And one of the rules in sports photography commonly is don't shoot the back of an athlete. You get their eyes, get their facial expression, get the front of them. Now, all rules are meant to be broken in photography, including sports photography. And if it just looks right and you get the right look, then sure, go ahead and do it. This is not the right look. This is a point and shoot shot again. What is up with the kid's face? Why he looks stoned, okay? Is that the photographer's fault? Yes, because why would you take that shot? And if you took the shot and you know, like concerts, people make weird faces in concerts when they're, you know, performing, they make weird faces. You get them when they're blinking, they look like they're out of it, or just a zombie. And, you know, that's not your fault that they're making that face, but it's your fault that you're saving the image. In this picture, no, point and shoot. Nothing's happening. It doesn't look good. It doesn't look right. Okay, the white balance is off. See the difference with the color? This is a little more bluish, whitish, and then this goes to orange. Their feet are, his feet are cropped off. It's just not good. And I know it was number 20, 25 and 6, I believe, the parents hired me. And I think it was all three of them. They wanted pictures of them. But still, what if she wanted to print this? Their arms are cut off. Their feet are cut off. It's just not good. Again, okay, it's repeating. I'm trying to find some action stuff. I mean, the guy never went on the field, so it was very difficult. But, you know, when that kind of stuff happens, I learned my lesson from this and asked them, are they, I don't know the term for it. I don't want to say something stupid. I think it's just a starter. Are they a starter? Do they even play in the game? Are they playing or are they on the sideline the whole time? You know, you got to ask that. This shot is out of focus. Yeah, I can't believe I took that. This is out of focus too. Wow. Whoa. What is this? See, going wide, I think it was a 28-135, the kit lens with the 7D. There's nothing happening. Again, that is the first thing you need to ask yourself. What is happening in this photo? Where does your eyes, where's your eyes being drawn to? What are you looking at? The first thing you look at in a photo. If it's not what you intended the viewers to look at right away, then it's probably crap. And if there's nothing happening, it's crap. In this photo, nothing's happening. They're just they're changing positions. They're getting ready for a new play. And they're swapping some of the athletes off the field for new ones. Nothing's happening. Nothing is happening. There is nothing special about this photo. Out of focus. Out of focus. No. It's... With people, with shots like this, when they're saying good game and stuff, you know, you just have to... You'll know when you get that right shot. Sometimes the best recommendation I can have for something like this is when you happen to see one athlete shaking hands with another one off outside of this whole lineup good game routine they do. Get really close to them with a wide angle and get very, very close. You can't be afraid to get close. You can never get too close. Just get in their face and get that. Feel the frame. That is like the number one, that is like the sports photography 101. Feel the frame. Try to get it right in the camera as much as you can. I don't care what camera body you have, how high resolution it is, even with the 1DX, you can't just fire shots off and just think, oh, I'll just crop it. You know, I'm not against cropping, but it sometimes you do have to, if you're low on shots for wire service or whatever it is, parents or whatever, you want to give them more shots, you know, you go ahead and do it and crop. But do your best to position yourself correctly. Do your best to fill the frame. It is so important to fill the frame. If you don't fill the frame, it's just bad. And out of focus. Again, these are so terrible. What was I thinking? My God. It's so embarrassing to look at these photos. Just, no. The horizon's off. It looks like they're falling off the earth. And the guy that's in focus, the pack player, number 99, he's not doing anything. It's just so bad. Sorry, I get so frustrated, especially when they're my photos, but even when I see other photographers take photos similar to this, I'm just like, what were they thinking? What was I thinking? What is this? These are bad photos. All of them are bad. Please feel free to ask, you know, questions. that you guys have if, you know, you want to know something, or what, if you're wondering why is that a bad photo and want me to go in more detail about it. But like this, like, it's just, no. It's not happening. I can't see the coach's face, which is the main subject from what it looks like. And the athletes aren't doing anything. There's no, I think they lost. So, you know, number 20 over there next to the coach on the right-hand side, he looks pissed. Not having it. You know, no. And you have to, I'm going to pass on the a quote from one of my favorite sports photographers. His name's Ryu. He's with Big Lens Fast Shutter. And I actually had a conversation with him on Facebook, and he taught me a lot, just with very few words he gave me. And, you know, I didn't even know this, but I guess you learn as you go. And he told me you have to be a chameleon. You've got to be able to do, you have to have your own style and do stuff for your own self, for your portfolio, and create a unique portfolio for your style. That has to be good, obviously. And you mold it as you go, and that's what I'm doing right now. My portfolio, I'm not satisfied with, and, you know, you'll see it soon enough. I'll show you guys. And, you know, you have to mold yourself into your own style and make it good, obviously. But the chameleon part comes into doing that, but simultaneously shooting for companies the way they want you to shoot. You can have your own style, and companies don't want that. So you have to be a chameleon in that sense. You have to, you know, shift styles as you're doing different jobs. So if parents are hiring you, you don't obviously, your keeper rate will be probably higher, because a shot that's very standard to you and everybody else, where, like, you know, a guy running, that football player running down the field with the ball, you know, a receiver running with the ball, isolated subject, a vertical shot, you know, it's a very standard shot. Those are keepers. Parents like those. Same with, you know, like max preps that cover high school. That's what they want. They want that stuff. And then, you know, every company has their requirements of shots that they want to see. And do they go in your portfolio if they're nice and clean and sharp? No. What goes in your portfolio is just wow factor, images that have a wow factor to it. There's another guy I talked to, I met online. His name's Orlando. He taught me this, and he's been helping me out, and I really appreciate his help. And he's been teaching me, you know, get images in your portfolio that have the wow factor, something that you don't see every day, something that just gives, it just catches your eye, and it's just good looking. It's just amazing. It's great. Like, God, these shots are so bad. I'm sorry. Look at these. Oh. You know, this is a good moment, but it's very hard under the circumstances that I'm in. You look at the shadow on his face. The only thing that can do take care of that is flash, which I didn't have at the time. I mean, the 7D has on-camera flash, but it's very crappy. Moving on. Nope. You know, after a game's done, especially if they lose, it's not a good idea to do a team photo. Look at the guy on the far right, 13. He looks depressed. And it's because they lost. You know, if you're going to do that, you got to make sure they won, or they're all happy, even if they lost. Some of them were happy, they didn't care. But other people were really upset that they lost. Yeah, they still look upset. 13, looks upset the whole time. You've got to really, with stuff like this, you just frame it right. Yeah. Get the lights in there too. I liked how, let me go back a little bit. Yeah, right there. That would have been good. Now, if everybody's looking at the camera, nobody was blinking, no one's faces were covered, there's some faces covered in the back, and people were all happy looking. You know, that didn't happen. I didn't take care of that. And if they don't look happy, you know, then they won't change that. You just got to move on and just forget it. Don't even bother. Yeah, see, this guy's crying. No. Oh, God. Help me. Oh, man. Yeah, that's a great shot. Yeah, there's totally stuff happening. Yep, game's over. God. All right, this is green, first off. It's out of focus, it looks like. Let me see. Dear God. Jeez. Whew. Yeah, no. If this was in focus, it would, you know, if I wanted to make this a perfect picture, if he was in focus, first off, he was looking at the ball, his eyes were visible, he's looking down, his eyes are closed, so no. And there was no ass over here on the right side of the frame, then it would be good. And it wasn't green. Out of focus, this one's out of focus, that one's out of focus. Let's move on. See the dead space and the arm coming in the frame right there? You know, the arms and, you know, limbs and body parts, those are going to happen, okay? If you can avoid it at all costs. The dead zone, though, look at above his head and below his feet. There's too much space there. It's way too much. Another 101, sports photography 101. Do not leave dead space. Tight is right. That rule can be broken. There's always wide-angle shots that look great, and I'll go over that more in my portfolio. Let's get out of here with the football. I can't take it anymore. You know, with soccer, same thing. This is a year later. I have the 1DX at this point in a 400mm 2.0 IS Mark I, so I've got top-end gear pretty much. And look at, my photos are still not that good. They're pretty bad. Look at this. Her feet are cut off. In this situation, I don't think I had a wide angle at the time, too. Like, you don't need the top-end gear to get the good photos. However, you do need the gear to get good photos. Like, it goes both ways. In this situation, people would ask, why are you using a 400 for a shot like that? Why don't you get on the field with a wide angle? Well, I would have, but I didn't have a wide angle at the time. I believe I was borrowing a fisheye from a friend, but it was raining in this situation. So it was a 15mm 2.8, I believe, from Canon, and that's not weather sealed, and I didn't want to risk it, even if it was, because it's not my gear. It's like $900, and I did not want to break it or damage it. So you are limited. So that is where gear comes in handy. But at the same time, look at the gear I have. I've got the zoom to get the frame full. I've got a fast camera, and I can't even get it properly framed. Look, it's tilted. That's my fault. And you learn as you go. And if you're taking shots like this, just learn from it and just, you know, fix it. And I've gotten better, obviously, but I can be so much better. And as long as you just keep pushing yourself, your photos will get better. Okay, right here. First off, the crop ratio looks totally weird. And all the dead space behind her. Why? Why is that dead space there? I needed to shift over to the left more. Put the camera, aim it to the left more, put the athletes over there in the frame more. No dead space. If you ever have this happen, just correct it next game. Just learn from it. Here again, dead space over here. You know, in the moment itself, that's what is happening in this moment. You know, yeah, she's going to, number 18 is about to try to steal the ball from 10, but nothing is happening. She's just standing there awkwardly. It just doesn't look good. Again, and the crop, this is before I learned about keeping the same ratio as your cropping, and I was just doing whatever the hell I wanted without holding shift, like in Lightroom and stuff. I did my own thing. It was really bad. This looks like it came out of a freaking IMAX movie with the wide screen. God. Okay, this one, I'm pretty sure that's a penalty in soccer. It's a good moment, but framed a little bit bad. Why, you know, be another 101 in sports photography 101. Don't center your subject. Sometimes you got to do that. If you're shooting vertically or you want to crop vertically, and you know, it's got to be in the center. And you know, times it's okay. It just, you'll know when you see it. In this, it looks awkward. That's a little bit of dead space over here on the left hand side. If I just, with the ball on the right side, I would shift them over to the left side of the frame. Because they're, one, the ball's over there on the right side. Give it a little more space. And then two, they're looking towards the ball. So always give them a little extra space to where they're looking at, to where they're running at. That's another 101 in sports photography. No. All right, I've had enough of these terrible images. God, these are so bad. Okay. Now, I'm going to show you what makes a sports image good. Get out of here. Over here. All right. Here's my portfolio. Now, again, I'm not fully happy with it. Yes, there are some great photos in here, but it could be so much better. And I told myself starting this year, I bought my third 1DX, so now I have three 1DX bodies, top of the end 400 2.8 IS Mark II, 7200 2.8 Mark IS Mark II, 1635 2.8 Mark II, 2470 2.8 Mark II, so many lenses, all high-end stuff. I've got to start putting that to use and start getting some top-notch images. And last year, I even had the 1DX, and it just wasn't, and it's not cutting it. I was not getting good images. And it's time I'm going to start cracking down on it this year, especially. I got the third 1DX, so I can have two bodies on me at all times. If I want to use one for a remote for basketball, soccer, volleyball, or whatever, that's what the third one's for mainly. Sometimes I can carry all three on me, but it's time to just learn how to get good images consistently and get a better portfolio and just work my way up. So, for those of you who are new to the channel, don't think that just because I have all the top-end gear, I think that I can take great images, because that's not the case. I am fully aware that I am not taking top-notch images, and I need to learn. I have a lot I need to learn, and that's fine. And there's nothing wrong with getting the top-end gear and still learning, because that's just dumb. I hate when people do that. They're like, "Oh, why do you need that? You don't need that. You're still learning." No, if you can afford it, get it. Why waste your money on cheaper end stuff if you're gonna end up getting the high end stuff if this is gonna be your career? If you can afford it, just get it and learn how to use it. That's the route I took personally, because I could afford it and I had help from family and friends. Okay, so back to the photos. This is one of my favorite photos that I've taken. Some people might be like, "Why? It's not that great of an image." But to me, I just love it. I like the way it looks. It looks really nice to me. Why is it good? There's enough space right here, so it's not like she's hitting a wall. If I wanted to fix this slightly, I would move her back to the right-hand side of the frame a little bit more. But this is a, it just looks right. And you've got the blurred background. She's sharp as a tack. And it's just got the school logo on it. It's just really nice. And I'm laying on my stomach. I'm really low level. That's the other thing. Don't ever stand up. When you're on a field or water polo or soccer, get low. Sometimes at pro events, you'll have to stand up, like soccer. I mean, sometimes you could sit, but they have that barricade that blocks you so you can't get low. But if you're able to lay down your stomach with swim, get low, get on their level. It makes your images so much better. Next, celebrations make a great photo. It's not always about the action. It's not always about the action. It's not always about the action. Remember that. It is so important. And people always, get that mistake. They make the mistake of thinking, "Oh, I just need action, 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 action." No. You don't. Sport images are not just action. They need sport images that are good tell a story. This shot tells a story. Everybody's happy. Everybody's celebrating. This guy's holding up his Top Dog trophy, and if you look, if you've got a big screen, you can see it has all the years that they've won in a row. And it's, what is it, 2003 through 2012. And I had people critique this photo and said to get closer. People don't know that there was a fence at chest level, and I got low and angled wide angle up. In case you're wondering what was shot with this shot, it was a 1DX with a 1635 2.8 Mark II. There was a fence right in front of me and a bunch of parents behind me, and I had to push my way through it, and I squatted down and tried to get as close as I could and fill the frame as much as I could with everybody. Without getting the fence in the shot, so I was kind of limited. But I really like this shot, and it tells a story, and it just looks right. You know that this is it. Just look at this photo, and then compare it to all the other shots that you saw in the football game. It's so bad, God. Next photo. Okay, this is a feature that is in the 1DX and 5D Mark III. It's called multiple exposure, and you can set it from 2 to 9, I believe, photos, and you take that many photos, and it'll put them and combine them. You can do this in Photoshop, yeah, but when you're shooting for a wire service, they don't want you to alter an image like that. They want you to get it right in the camera and, you know, do basic edits, contrast and all that. They don't want you to do multiple layers and all this stuff, and you don't have time to do it anyway. So if you're wondering, oh, I can just do that with a cheaper camera. Why do I need a 1DX or a 5D Mark III? And you don't need to make these photos, but hey, it gives you more variety and it looks pretty cool. The image itself, I mean, it's just there to fill my portfolio, honestly, right now. I'm probably going to delete it once I get a better one. But it's just there for now. It's okay. It could be better, though, I think. But this is another idea that you can do. Moving on. Mud runs. This was great. There was a truck pouring water out on the athletes as they were running. And this guy's just got a lot of character. He's pretty intense. He's got a badass face, a bunch of tattoos, looks pissed, got the bandana. And it's just, I really like this shot. Got the water coming down. It looks like it's raining almost. It's pretty cool. Okay, this shot. I love this shot, but I am so mad about the lighting conditions and like the background's blown out, and that was way worse before. I shot raw, luckily, and they were way underexposed. But sometimes it's okay for like Ryu was talking about this. You can get silhouettes instead, and it can look great. If you want to look at Ryu's portfolio, check it out. If you go and Google big lens fast shutter, and then go into the people that are involved, it says it on the top somewhere on their website, and you go to Ryu and you'll see his portfolio. Check it out. He's got some silhouette stuff. He's all about that. But yeah, this is a peak of action shot. Ignoring the lighting conditions, you've got a peak of action happening here. It makes you wonder, you know, what's going to happen. You've got the ball in midair, they're both intense, making crazy faces. And the American player is about to kick the ball. He's got his knee coming up, and it's an intense shot. Celebrations again. I love this shot a lot. Lots of happiness, lots of joy. They won the game after extra innings were going on for a while, and it's just celebration. Celebration shots are great, and getting close up like that with a clean background, no distractions, is great. These moments, to be in that right spot, especially with pro events, this is LA Dodgers, obviously. Being at a pro event, you're very limited. You can't go on the field, even after the game. And they were right in front of me at third base. I was using the 400, and after the play was done, they all ran out there right in front of us, and I happened to be there. If I was over on the first base area, where the photo well is, it would have just been backs. I got their faces. And just being at the right place at the right time. So that's another thing with sports photography 101. Sometimes you're just going to miss shots. And it's a lot of it is luck and being in the right place at the right time and just being ready. So on top of being at the right spot and on top of it being at the right time, you know, you have to just be ready. You have to be ready for that moment. You have to anticipate it happening and just be prepared. This shot, you can see the ball, which is great. It's not so much action happening. This is what I'm talking about when I say I'm not fully happy with my portfolio. You've got the dive, you've got the dirt coming up and all that, but it could be a lot better. If you're going to put something like this in your portfolio, it's got to be more action, something crazy happening. This is just, you know, a typical steal at second base dive, and she's got, it's just, the only thing that's special about it is that, you know, she's got the glove out, and you can see the ball in the glove, and which is great, and it's a close-up, but this is just an example to show, you know, get tight frame it tightly, and get in there, and fill the frame, get the blurred background, which is a clean background, and yeah, so moving on. Now, wide shots are great, too. Wide-angle lenses, they have their purpose, whether it's celebrations or to go to the very, very, very top of a stadium and filling the frame with the entire place and just getting an image that you just wouldn't see every day. Because this was taken at a media room way up top in the Kings, in the Staples Center. So not everybody has that access. So what better way of getting an image by going up to where people are, can't go and get that shot. So, yeah. Panning. Panning is an effect where you put a slow shutter speed, and I believe, I'm still learning with this, so sorry. You keep image stabilizer turned on if you have it. Keep your elbows not like this. Keep them down and hold your breath and keep the, just be very still and steady because you have a slow shutter speed and you're panning them. You're following your subject with a slow shutter speed and you're bursting shots off. And I don't know if you can see it or not, but his face is in focus and the rest of it is blurred, but it's not like bokeh. It's not bokeh. It's just like a motion blur to show that there's movement going on. So that's a little cool thing, but again, this could be way better, but it's just an example to show you guys the effect. If you get it right, it can look great. You just got to keep trying, though. It's not something that you can just do one time and be like, oh, I got it. This shot, wide shot, getting the little block barricade thingy over in the bottom left of the frame, just and it just shows you how close we are to the athletes and just gives you a view that you normally wouldn't see. And Puig is obviously a very, very popular athlete in baseball. He's very big. And so it's a shot that would get, it just shows you a view that you normally wouldn't see. Showing, being the photographer, your job is to get shots that other people can't get and get, show the viewers give them a perspective that they normally can't see. And this is a good example. Fisheye. This is a fun day. I was just walking at the park, a local park, and saw this guy doing crazy stuff. And it's like, hey. And I was borrowing my friend's fisheye, 15mm, 2.8, shot on the 1DX. And he was just going crazy. And this is as close as I could get to him, I'm pretty sure, without him kicking me in the lens. Cause it looks like he's not that close-ish, but I mean, if you took the camera off your eyes and looked right in front of you, his face is like right here. There's his foot is like right there. It was crazy. But yeah, getting the fisheye is a very special type of lens. You don't want to use it every day. You got to be careful not getting your shadow in there. If you're gonna use it, you got to fill the frame. With wide-angle lenses, they're very difficult to use. You've got to fill the frame. Get close to the athlete. That's all the photos I have in my portfolio. So that's pretty much the conclusion of this video is what makes a sports image good? Isolation, which is blurring the background, keeping your subject as the the main thing to view and not have any distractions. At sporting events, you've got all those ugly signs and commercials all in the back, baseball and football and all that stuff. So having a lens with a 2.8 aperture or getting a long telephoto lens with a very low aperture is very important. That's why I always recommend the 2.8 lenses. Yes, they're expensive, but they're expensive for a reason. They're very good. They do the job, and they give you – the higher-end ones will obviously give you more higher keeper rate because they are more accurate with the autofocus. So isolation, framing it right, filling the frame is very important. I'm not against cropping. A lot of people are. Yes, it's bad to crop. I am against cropping when it's overdone. You don't want to overcrop. Get it right in the camera as much as you can. There could be action happening really far away. I don't care how crazy it is. Why are you going to shoot it if you're going to be cropping like 50% plus? No. I mean, there's some exceptions to that, okay? Don't get me wrong. Sometimes you're shooting for a wire service and there's something that crazy extreme scenario and a historical moment is happening and everybody else around you is firing, you're just sitting there, oh, I'm not gonna fire because it's too far, I don't want to crop, blah blah blah. That, okay, go ahead and shoot it. You know, there's exceptions to every rule. These are basic rules. So isolation, filling the frame, don't overcrop, get it right in the camera as much as you can. That goes for exposure, framing, cropping, the filling the frame, all that. Just that is what makes a sports image good. Something that tells a story, something that gets your eyes drawn attention to the main subject. You're not distracted with all these things in the image that are not part of it. That's the other thing. People take pictures, and if they don't get it right in the camera and they crop it, they still have athletes that are in the picture that have nothing to do with the play that's happening, if there's a play happening. get those guys out of there or just wait. But I can't tell you how many times I am shooting with a 400 millimeter and I don't shoot if something's happening because it's too far away. It sucks. And you may be like, 400 too far away? How's that possible? It is possible, especially on a full frame. Here's an example. I had this guy next to me one day. I had a 400 1DX. He had a 7100 Nikon with a kit lens. I think it was like 1855 or something. And there's baseball going on. Guy hits a fly an outfield ball. Way outfield. I've got a 400. I'm not shooting it. Too far. Way too far. Even looking through it, they look like ants. Guy next to me, click, 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 click. He's just going off. And even when the guy catches the ball and he was walking back, click, 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 just still going. And he's like, why aren't you shooting? And I look at him like, the better question is, why are you shooting? Let me see your shot. And he shows me, I got him. He looks like an ant. So, yeah, just because action happens doesn't mean fire away. So, I hope this video helped you guys out, and, you know, if you guys have any questions, feel free to ask me in the comments. This is probably going to be a long video. I can't see the time on it, but I know it's long. But I hope this was a very helpful video, and you guys learned from it. Again, if you guys have any questions, comment. Thanks, guys. See you later.